on action, the camera was right on my face on me, and I was cutting the orange, and a juice of orange squirted in my eye, and I started crying. And it was when Killian was yelling his line, and it perfect moment, a tear rolled down my cheek when I looked at Killian.
And, hi, Millie. Hi, Emily.
Hi, nice to meet you.
So lovely to meet you. How are the both of you doing today?
I'm really good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm on the West Coast, so it's 9 o'clock, which is early for me. But other than that, it's good. So are you having tea this midday for you? Yeah. Yes, cheers.
What kind are you drinking?
I'm just having a good old builder's brew. So I'm from England, so that's what we call just breakfast tea.
I have Earl Grey with a little bit of milk, little bit of cream. So
very nice. Are you a tea person?
A little bit, yeah. I'm warming up to tea. I started drinking tea while filming A Quiet Place with Noah because it really helped me recently. So now I drink coffee too. So both, a little bit of. What about you?
Oh my goodness, such a tea person. I don't think I could go a day without tea, honestly. It's such a stereotype, but it's so true.
Do you have any favorites? Do you have any recommendations for me?
So I'm a fan of a good herbal tea. Also, there's this type of tea I've discovered recently. Like, it's called yogi tea. And I like it because it has a little message on the paper thing.
Yeah, no, I think I've had that. I don't think I've had yogi tea. I've had ginger, green tea. Those are the only two I like.
Excellent. Well, keep exploring the tea world. Okay, so you were recently nominated as an EE Rising Star. Congratulations.
Thank you. It's not expected at all. I really only hope that people would enjoy the film. I hope it, you know, they would have a good time watching it, but I didn't think that anything would come out of this for me personally. So I appreciate it. And to be with the other brilliant actors in the category is, wow, it's been an interesting journey so far. I heard you are a composer, and I'm really interested in that. What made you get into that specifically for film?
So I do mainly film composing, as you said, and I think for me it kind of just started as a love of watching films as a child and hearing those scores and thinking, oh my goodness, I've got to do this, and then slowly putting the work in and learning how to, you know, orchestrate and create mock-ups to be convincing. And yeah, and music's been a huge part of my life, and it seems like a very natural thing for me to do.
Why do you feel music is so important in film? What is your experience, and what does that mean for you?
I mean, for me, it's part of the storytelling. Sometimes if you're watching a film and you're not noticing the music, it means it's doing its job and you're really feeling the emotions of the scene. It's something that's not at the forefront all the time, but it's really influencing what you're feeling as a viewer, and it's kind of indispensable in that sense. But at the same time, there's nothing wrong with like super epic music either, which is, you know, a great theme tune or anything. It just plays a multitude of roles, and it's something I find so inspiring. Do you have a particular relationship with music yourself? I read that you really like the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Yes, I loved music. I've had my mom influenced me a lot for music. She played violin all growing up. And with an implant, I'm able to enjoy music. I've never, you know, become professional or good at anything myself. What about you? Did you grow up playing an instrument?
Yeah, I played piano. I did a bit of singing as well, but I've kind of stopped that now. Strictly composing these days. Do you have a particular relationship to film scores? How does, and especially I'm really interested to know how you kind of view scores of films you've been in.
For A Quiet Place, for part one, I don't think a lot of people would think to use sound to become as, you know, a weapon. So as far as sound goes in the movie, it was really interesting. And, you know, I think, to use that, to use the lack of sound to become, to make it more scary, you don't really think about that. Usually the music gets louder, you know? So it was fun to experiment with the sound in that film, in the first film. My experience was, you know, to offer John my experience as a deaf person. And it was really cool to see my experience on screen, you know, to show people whatever they take from it, you know, whatever they learn from it.
The relationship sound has to a film, it's basically, it's such a large part of the experience. And the fact that they were able to recreate your experience through film as well is, I think, something quite amazing.
And I heard that it's your dream to work with Jeff Russo someday. Why is that? He's very important in your career.
I mean, I love Star Trek. I've always loved Star Trek. My family are Trekkies. Are you a fan yourself?
No, I've never watched an episode. I'm so sorry.
No, that's fine. He does the music for Discovery and Picard. And I just love all that sci-fi stuff. I'd love to ask you, though, a little bit more about A Quiet Place and some stuff that happened behind the scenes, because it's such a terrifying film, both of them. And I just want to know, was there any moment which was just funny or memorable?
There was a funny moment, actually, on part two. And it was day one, where the aliens, you know, come up, initially attack. And it was at the baseball game with John and Killian. And I had to cut oranges. For some reason, on action, the camera was right on my face, on me. And I was cutting the orange, and a juice of orange squirted in my eye. And I started crying. And it was when Killian was yelling his line. And a perfect moment, a tear rolled down my cheek when I looked at Killian. And I think Killian saw it, and but I was crying, and I didn't want to ruin the take. I didn't want to break my character. And so we just kept going. And after the cut, I went up to Killian and I said, "Killian, I am so sorry. I did not mean to cry in that scene. I was not trying to throw you off." And he just laughed. He just thought it was so funny. Also, sometimes on set when John was not anywhere, and I was getting ready, and it was a really scary scene and we were getting ready to film something. There was a scene I'm thinking of where I'm in the train and I was reaching for that first aid kit. Where the skeleton or the corpse jumps out at me, right? We were practicing without the skeleton. I was pushing the door, and one time I saw John jump out from behind the door and yell at me, and I accidentally screamed a bad word. So they couldn't use that take, obviously.
That's hilarious. I have such an image of the orange just kind of going.
Oh, it was terrible.
So other than kind of the projects you've been working on recently, I'd love to know what you see for yourself down the line. What would you like to be doing in some years' time?
So right now I'm working on a TV show that is an adaptation from a book from a deaf author named Sarah Novak. It's about a deaf girl in high school. Her parents don't sign with her. And so it's kind of about her. She needs to find her own deaf identity. And all of a sudden, you know, her life changes and she needs to transfer to deaf school. And, you know, she finally finds out about the culture and her deaf identity. And there's some romance in it. And it's kind of a young adult novel, and I'm also executive producing on it. So I'm a little bit behind the scenes. So that's been really interesting. And I've loved learning about that process.
That's great. I mean, what have you learned from doing that behind the scenes work that you hadn't got from your acting work previously?
It's a really slow process. There's a lot of moving parts. There's a lot of things you need to get right. There's a lot of collaborations. You know, I feel like it's more your baby when you're involved in the process and you share your ideas. You know, it's been a really cool experience so far, just to meet with different directors and you know, showrunners, and to see their vision and what they want out of their career. And it's been really inspiring for me. It made me really think about my own career and what I, you know, what I want to be eventually. And what about you? What are you working on? What do you see for yourself?
So I'm currently a student at the Conservatory in San Francisco. So I've been doing things like shorts, and I hope to be doing some stuff on the festival circuit this summer, and carrying on kind of just up that trajectory of, you know, doing smaller films and slightly larger films and so on and so forth.
That's awesome.
And the other thing I've done a lot of actually is ballet. Random, right? Because I love ballet. I grew up watching ballet. I could never dance ballet. Oh my God, no. No one wants to see that. But that's the sort of thing which I've written a lot of music for. And the differences between film and ballet are vast. Because film, you know, the music happens after the film is made mostly, but ballet, it's much more of a collaborative process, and not to say things can't change after it's been sort of blocked. Do you ever watch any ballet or do any dancing yourself?
No, but I've watched a few Broadway plays like Hamilton. Oh, the Nutcracker, obviously, when I was younger, it was always popular. I loved going to see that. But I'm a fan of it. I grew up in a drama club for years and years in middle school, so I love drama and the stage.
Amazing.
Someday I would love to, you know, get back.
Yeah.
Any Broadway favorite plays or any favorite like stage plays that you've seen?
It's rubbish because COVID basically closed everything down, didn't it?
But
other than that, before that, which I think was like in 2019, I saw Come From Away in London. It's, if you haven't seen it.
I don't think I've heard of that.
You haven't seen it. I'm not sure. I think it's on in New York as well. I cried my eyes out for about an hour and a half, and it was incredible. Try and catch it if you can.
Okay, I will absolutely try and take you up on that.
I heard you're going to London soon, actually, aren't you?
Soon. I leave on Sunday. So I'm so excited for that. I've never been.
Right. But
I have friends who live there. So I'm really excited to see them and to see everything, you know. You have so much to offer there. And, you know, English tea, obviously.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'd love to ask you just one more thing, if that's okay. I'd love to know, what is your mantra?
Oh, that's a good one. But recently I've been learning, you know, this year about what it's like to be, you know, my journey with my deafness and my identity. And I realize I can't represent, you know, my whole community. It's been a different experience for me. I need to tell my experience, my story, my identity, you know, and there's not one way to be deaf. I want to show diversity even within the deaf community and different disabilities. So it's been really interesting experience for me just this last year.
And what you said about representation and telling your own story is all you can do. I think that is true representation, honestly. And what a fantastic thing that is. Thank you, Millie. It's been...
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Lovely to talk to you. I'm so pleased I got this opportunity.
Me too. Thank you so much. And good luck with your journey. And I wish you all the best. And I hope you get to work with Jeff.
That would be fantastic. Well, I'll be leaving San Francisco soon enough, so we'll see.
crossed.